Hello. Welcome to another installment of Media Literacy 101. My name is Jens Sundum, and I work for the Missoula Forum for Children and Youth. I hope you've been enjoying our presentations so far. We've been talking about alcohol and tobacco, among other things, parenting around the media. I hope even more so than enjoying them, you're almost getting a little upset at what the media is feeding us. So today, obviously, we'll be looking at eating as an obsession and nutrition in what we and our children see all the time in the media. So let me start out here with a video that you may recognize some of the characters in. Let me play that back for you again.
Nothing for you.
Come on.
Come back when you're thinner.
To learn more about people trying to control what you eat, go to consumerfreedom.com.
No food for you.
Now, this ad is created by a group of companies that sell junk food. Okay, they're hiding behind the name Consumer Freedom because they don't want people to look at, they know that if people were watching this ad and they knew it was junk food people making it, that they wouldn't like look too kindly at it. But this ad is sponsored by McDonald's, Coke, and a couple other companies that sell junk food. Now, this ad is making the claim that the government shouldn't tell you what you can eat. In fact, the government doesn't tell people what they can eat. It only recommends about what foods are healthy to eat. The government does, however, tell companies that they cannot sell harmful products or unhealthy food. Now, these regulations that require simple safety rules, like selling disease-infected meat, is a no-no, or that food has poison in it, should be recalled. Junk food companies make commercials like this because they're worried that the government is going to put regulations on them that limit their ability to sell food that make people get fat. Here's some facts for you. You can decide if the obesity epidemic in America is a big enough problem to require junk food companies to start selling healthier food. Percent of adults are overweight, and almost half of those are obese. Unhealthy eating and inactivity kills between 310,000 and 580,000 people every single year. That's 20 times more people than are killed by illegal drugs. Besides the 113 million Americans living life overweight and obese without disease, another 100 million have diseases ranging from high blood pressure to diabetes, heart disease, and stroke. This costs us Americans $524 billion to treat these diet and inactivity related diseases. So ask yourself, you think we should start regulating junk food companies so that the food they sell is more healthy? Well, the ad we saw on the scales makes it look like food corporations really care about your rights. Well, let's look at this next ad. Ask yourself how these food companies really look at you. Technical difficulties, but in this ad, pretty much, these people are out in the wheat fields like wild animals eating beef jerky. And the ad tells us to feed our wild side. Now the question is, who is really wild in the ad? All the people eating the snack foods were shown just be standing around. They're just mindlessly munching their jerky. And what happened is this helicopter shows up and starts flying over them. They run away just like a herd of wild animals until one of them, you know, gets shot with a tranquilizer from the helicopter. They end up getting tagged in the ear. It's a really funny commercial, but after I'm done laughing, I have to think about things. I have to think about how disturbed I actually am. I think this is how Jack's Jerky, who the commercial is for, And a lot of the other junk food companies think about us. They think that we are just animals they can herd around, shoot and tag whenever they want to. They show us as just standing around all day eating their junk food, as if it's the natural thing to do. And of course, they call this being wild in this commercial. Now, what we're going to talk about today is we're going to look at how junk food companies use ads to try to convince people that it's normal to be obese with eating. The messages of the ads I'm going to show you can all be boiled down to one same thought. Eating this product makes your life better. In some of the ads, the products make problems go away. In others, it makes good things seem better. Either way, junk food ads like these play a large role in promoting obesity. They transform eating from a source of substance into a source of obsession. Now, I'm going to only show you ads for products that are loaded with sugar and fat, the two things that cause the most obesity in our diets. Let's see if we can get to one for potato chips. Did you notice how the ad began? The platform was totally empty, and all of a sudden, people materialized on it. The same time, the woman is shown biting into the chip. Watch the beginning again. See, the message here, it's very subtle, but it's powerful. There is no life without the potato chips. The people and the good time they were having didn't exist until they began eating the product. The rest of the ad shows how the people interact with the product in ways that make them even more happy and joyful. And the ad ends with them all moving in unison to save the product from slipping into the water. And of course, this, according to the ad, lets the good times roll. This next ad has a similar theme. Young boy is crazy bored until he consumes the product that's advertised. And once he drinks a soda pop, then he's able to get a card that gets hooked up.
Looking for something better to do?
Ads like these try to convince us that eating or drinking the junk food product advertisers are trying to sell us make our lives that much more exciting and happier. This next ad is also designed to convince people that soda pop is needed to be happy and enjoy life. But rather than tell us how bored we are with the product advertised, like this Coke ad just did, this one tries to associate something we already enjoy with the product being sold. It does this by cutting back and forth between images of what we enjoy with images of the product. This is done in time to catchy music. Now, this particular ad uses sports images. It's one of my favorite ads because I think it shows us a lot.
There's no stealing your thunder. No, it can't be contained.
Now, this is an old ad, and I'm showing you it because it really clearly demonstrates the formula that so many other ads use. I also like this ad because it uses many of the techniques that make me like watching TV.
There's no stealing your thunder.
You see, I like the music, I like the editing, I like the people in the ad, how they're moving in time to the music. It's got the chicken in it.
No, it can't.
Aw, the kids are happy. Oh, the girl team are happy. Man, even grandma's happy.
You fill me with wonder and cool me off like rain. You're a part of me, that's the high.
Man, this lady is so happy, she's crying. Oh, here the ad is intergenerational. You know, the younger guys helping the old guy on the stairs.
The melody.
Oh, this is the best part. Right here in the song, it says, "Together we have harmony." Here's a black guy picking up some white guy he just knocked down. You know what? Because of Dr. Pepper, we have racial harmony. Wow, thank you, Dr. Pepper.
Together we are harmony.
Dr. Pepper, you're a part of me.
That's why I like the ad. You know, it makes me feel good. But take a moment to think about what it's really selling. All it's selling is flavored water that's loaded with a heck of a lot of sugar and caffeine. Now, besides the obesity problem I was telling you about, there's also a problem that comes from consuming lots of caffeine. See, caffeine leaches the calcium out of your bones. So not only are teenagers drinking something without calcium in it, they're drinking something that takes away the calcium that they already have, resulting in weaker bones. Now, this especially affects girls. Many girls today who drink a lot of pop are going to suffer from osteoporosis when they're older. That's the disease where your bones get brittle. Old people who do it do things like break their hips when they fall down. And now people are starting to get it younger and younger. We have a whole generation that's going to suffer from osteoporosis. But according to Dr. Pepper, that's okay, because we get racial harmony out of the deal. You see how soda pop ads really get you to focus on how fun it is to drink their product, rather than on the problems you'll have from doing so? You know that teenage girls who drink soft drink suffer broken bones 3 times as often as girls who don't. You don't have to wait until you're old for your bones to be harmed by drinking so much caffeine. Now, like I said, this is a pretty old Dr. Pepper commercial. It's over 10 years old. But you know what? We have new ones too, and they use the exact same technique, just a little bit subtler. You ready?
What you seeing didn't start with LL today. Take it from me, Run DMC paved the way with Jam Master J, the KINGs. Run D and Dr. Pepper, that's originality. The taste of Dr. Pepper.
Dr. Pepper.
The taste of originality. Salutes individuality.
Individual.
Gives life personality. Be you, do what you do.
Be you,
nothing better than Dr. Pepper.
Run DMC and Jam
Dr. Pepper.
See, instead of sports images in this one, they use hip-hop images. What's kind of weird is how this ad tells people to be you. I was listening to that's what it's saying, right? Be you. But it's weird because to be you, you're supposed to do what they're telling you to do. It raps about individuality when it's selling a product that millions of people consume. How individual is that? You know, just like the sports ad we saw from 10 years ago, this Dr. Pepper ad is trying to associate the product with a lifestyle that people enjoy. You know, Dr. Pepper uses the same basic formula in dozens of its commercials, trying to reach a broad audience. Sometimes instead of hip-hop, they have a country western version of the exact same ad.
There's a light in your soul. Says you're one of a kind. Don't never let go. Be original, an individual, like Dr. Pepper. Be you, do what you do. Be you, do what you do.
Oh, Dr. Pepper continues their individuality theme in this ad by telling you that if you drink their soda pop, you'll be one of a kind. Now, I hope you realize how advertisers almost always use ads to tell you the exact opposite of the truth. You're not one of a kind if you drink Dr. Pepper. You're not even unique in your taste because you like country music. The last ad had hip-hop musicians telling you the exact same thing. And just to not leave anybody out, here's one using salsa dancing for Latinos.
El ritmo latino original, como nos hace bailar, Tito Puente.
Como Dr. Pepper muy fuerte, el sabor de la originalidad, sanando la individualidad, dando a tu vida personalidad.
Sé tú, a tu manera, sé tú.
See, these ads are all great fun to watch, but you know what? They really start to get old and lose their appeal once you see how it's just the same old message recycled over and over. The only difference is how they try to make it more personally meaningful by associating their product with different entertainment interests. Now, I spent this time focusing on Dr. Pepper because it's really easy to see how phony their ads are. But I'm hoping that you'll transfer the same understanding to the ads that other junk food companies use. The obsessive consumption of food they show is just as fake. The only question is whether or not you're going to buy into it. The message in these Dr. Pepper ads is that if I want to enjoy living the kind of life they're showing me, I must consume the product, supposed to be an important part of that lifestyle. Now, this next Dr. Pepper ad has a little bit of a twist to it. Instead of saying how fun it is to lead a lifestyle that consumes their product, this ad trashes all other lifestyles that don't use their product.
Taste buds, two kinds. The little yes man sitting at the tip of your tongue sipping new age mango flavored tap water, and the boys in the back of the class getting all the glory. So for them, there's new Red Fusion from Dr. Pepper. Red Fusion, who's your soda?
Now I want to play this for you one more time, and I want you to really pay attention to the words that are being said. Really listen to what they're saying in this ad.
Taste buds, two kinds. The little yes man sitting at the tip of your tongue sipping new age mango flavored tap water, and the boys in the back of the class getting all the glory. So for them, there's new Red Fusion from Dr. Pepper. Red Fusion, who's your soda?
You see how this ad trashes, quote, the little yes men sipping new age mango flavored tap water, while it glorifies the boys in the back of the room getting all the glory. What's really funny about this ad is how stupid the sales pitch is. It says that the soda being sold is special because it's red. Red. It's just red. Now, also notice who this ad is appealing to. The boys in the back of the class. The people who sit in the back have their reasons. And do you think that drinking red soda is one of them? No. Now, in one sense, the ad is saying, it's okay you're behind other people or in the back of things. You drink red soda, so it's cool. Rather than simply associate the product with a lifestyle people enjoy, this Dr. Pepper ad trashes people who drink water and therefore are less likely to be obese, while it praises people who participate in school from the back of the room. This next ad goes even farther. It directly appeals to students who do poorly in school. It's another older ad, but notice how it makes fun of failing grades, makes it okay for the girls to do it.
So what'd you get in history?
Terrible.
Next in line.
How about you?
Not good.
Algebra?
Real bad.
You?
Awful.
So when did these things get mailed?
I think Friday.
Oh, well we should be
next
fine.
In line.
Oh yeah, we're good.
Hi, we need to change of address forms, please.
Two.
Smarter than your average cookie. Twix.
So this ad tells you that lying about getting failing grades is a smart thing to do. It suggests that doing so makes you smarter than the average cookie. Earlier I told you how the central theme in all the ads we'll be seeing today is that eating the junk food that's advertised will make your problems go away and your life better. This ad implies that eating candy makes you feel better about getting failing grades. This next ad does the same thing. The difference is that instead of school, the candy now makes the problems you have from acting stupidly at work disappear.
I'm Boss Harris.
I run this place with an iron fist, cheap suits, and really bad breath.
Holy man, Harris is a complete... Mr. Harris.
A complete what?
Need a moment? Chew it over with Twix.
In fact, this next ad shows how the product actually makes it so you can't even hear about the problems you're facing at work.
Hi, Johnson. Yeah, listen, we've decided we're gonna have to let you go. You're fired. You're taking this well. You'll go far with that attitude. Only not here, because you're fired.
Kellogg's Raisin Bran Crunch, with tasty raisins, crunchy flakes, and honey granola clusters. It's the Raisin Bran with crunch. Sounds good.
So what if you're getting fired? This ad tells you that you've got sugar-coated cereals, so doesn't even matter. And it's not just the problems that junk food products can block out. Advertisers want you to believe that their products are so important to your life that it doesn't even matter if using them blocks out good things as well.
So I work at a children's hospital. I'm sure some people would quit after winning a lottery, but you know, I hope I'm not being too forward, but I feel this real connection to you.
Diet cherry vanilla Dr. Pepper.
Phenomena. Phenomena. Phenomena.
Diet cherry vanilla Dr. Pepper. Tastes so good, you'll get lost in it.
So what if a great guy who's won the lottery likes you? What's important is that you zone out over how much you like the advertised product. Now, according to ad like these, it's the product that enables you to be happy. It's the product that you have a connection to. When you think about it, what really makes a person zone out like this? Well, the answer, of course, is drugs. Even though this ad is a joke, it acknowledges how soda pop companies want you to value their products more than the good things in your life, just as drug addicts value their high more than anything else. In this next ad, we see how a person is willing to let his prized possessions get trashed just because he's offered junk food.
The chicken enchilada grilled stuffed burrito.
How about this one?
Oh, don't touch. Yeah.
Hey, guys. Chicken enchiladas.
My cards.
Smothered in melty, saucy, cheesy goodness.
Smothered?
On the inside. Oh.
The chicken enchilada grilled stuffed burrito from Taco Bell. Slow simmered savory enchilada sauce. Tender all white meat chicken and melted cheese. Wrapped up, then grilled to go.
So what's that word?
Okay. For enchilada taste, think outside the bun.
And it's not just possessions that advertisers want you to believe their junk food products are more important than. They want you to think that their products are more important than people. This next ad, Taco Bell, is asking us to believe that their products are even more valuable than your relationships.
Crunchy tortilla strips. For a taco salad that's even better than the original, think outside the bun.
Junk food advertisers make commercial after commercial telling people that acting stupid and lying is okay, because doing so gets you their product.
No nomination this year, huh?
Bummer.
Yeah, well, what are you gonna do, right?
Man.
Oh, hey, would you grab me a Diet Pepsi?
Sorry, last one. You just can't win tonight.
These aren't even hot.
I know. That was just a little bit of acting. Thanks, man.
Nothing performs like a Diet Pepsi. It's the Diet Cola.
In fact, they want you to believe their products are so incredibly important to have that even fighting over them is okay.
You want to see how powerful Sunkiss really is? Watch this. Oh, girls! Sunkiss, experience the charge.
Now, of course, these ads are funny, since they're made with actors who purposely look stupid. Or video game style, like this last one was, it's easy to dismiss the ads as not being serious. But if you don't think these ads are serious, then ask yourself why so many of them all have the same message. Whether it's a joke or not, if you show them often enough, the message will start to sink in. What's creepy about the Sunkist ad is that the models automatically start fighting over the soda pop. It's like they can't even control themselves. It's like they're obsessed. Oh, I forgot. They're supposed to be obsessed. The whole message these ads are sending is that being obsessed over food is no big deal. The advertisers want you to be obsessed. There are so many ads like these that just justified poor behavior as a reason to consume junk food. It was only a matter of time before some advertiser made an ad that came straight out and said, "Consume our product because you act badly."
Manager.
Some of you may have gotten the wrong idea about Subway.
Hey, it's okay. It's Subway.
No, what we meant was, if you eat a good low-fat diet of Subway, it's okay to occasionally eat bad, not be bad.
Oh.
So you, Kelly in Memphis, stop spilling on bad tippers. And you, Lori and Mike, stop trying to bring back fan art. And Lance, stop using puppies to meet girls. No, not that either. And sorry, Wang Chung, no reunion tour. So remember, people, delicious low-fat Subway sandwiches. And for your low-carb goals, the new Atkins-friendly chicken bacon ranch wrap and turkey and bacon melt wrap. They help make up for eating bad, not being bad. Subway, good, so you don't always have to be.
Now, the good news is that Subway does offer low-fat products on about a quarter of its menu or so. And for most people, as long as you're only buying the 6-inch sides, those sandwiches can be pretty healthy. But look at how this ad sells you food products that are supposed to be healthy. It says, go ahead and eat other food that's bad for you, since you're also eating some food that's good for you. See, advertisers are so hooked into the notion that food must be sold as an obsession that even when they offer products that can be healthy, they present them as a justification to continue eating unhealthy foods. Now, of course, mixed messages like these can make you crazy. But since junk food advertisers want you to eat crazy, they don't worry if their ads are crazy making. In fact, many advertisers encourage you to act crazy. Since they're selling food obsessively, they often make ads showing people engaging in dangerous behavior as a way to get the product that they are selling. Because advertisers want to create in viewers an obsession to consume their products, it's common for them to show an ad where people who use their product act in extreme, dangerous ways. Here's one for Mountain Dew.
Put her in a good spot, okay?
Here is everyone's worst valet parking nightmare.
Remember earlier I talked about how some junk food ads show people acting like they're on drugs? Well, the truth of the matter is, caffeine is a drug. It's mildly addicting. So it makes sense for products that contain large amounts of caffeine to advertise their products as if they were pushing a high drug. A drug high, sorry. Remember, the whole point of this kind of marketing is to make having junk food obsession appear to be normal. So if the product does actually contain addictive properties, it would make sense for advertisers to stress the kind of buzz you can get from consuming the product. Now, they do this by showing very exciting ads like we've just seen. After you watch the ad, you feel excited because your body releases a very small amount of adrenaline. The advertiser is hoping you'll associate the adrenaline rush you feel while watching the ad with the caffeine rush you'll feel while drinking Mountain Dew. Now, since junk food ads link consuming their product with an obsessive need, again, it would make sense to show ads offering both product day and night.
I'm tired of eating all this junk at night.
You got a better idea.
Hey, guys, over here. All right, punch it.
Satisfy those late night cravings at Wendy's pickup window.
Welcome to Wendy's.
Everybody hide.
We make everything fresh, from our hot and juicy hamburgers to our spicy chicken sandwich, till midnight or later.
It's good to be nocturnal.
Do Wendy's. Do what tastes right.
Notice the language in the ad. It even starts out with one raccoon saying, "I'm tired of eating all this junk." Even though the ad shows them picking through garbage, we know what they're talking about is junk food. Wendy's is trying to say that their products are different from all the others. They aren't selling garbage. The ad then shows the kind of extreme behaviors we've seen in many of the ads I've shown today. They steal a car, they crash it around since they're raccoons and can't drive. After they pull up at Wendy's, the ad says, "Satisfy those late night cravings." This line really tells you what the ad is all about. According to the ad, cravings are the things you are supposed to satisfy. Being obsessed over their food product is okay, the ad says, since they can give it to you late at night and make you satisfied. Now, eating before you go to sleep is one of the best ways to ensure that your body turns the food you eat into fat instead of burning it as calories. But instead of warning people this kind of behavior can contribute to being overweight or obese, Wendy stays open late at night and encourages people to satisfy their cravings by eating there. Not only that, but that ad also encourages you to go ahead and steal to get it. The raccoons didn't pay for that meal. Raccoons hid, grabbed it, and drove off as the guy looking out the window couldn't do anything about it. Now, I started this lesson by showing you an ad by junk food companies trying to make it seem like they cared about you. You remember? On the scale, consumer freedom. They were arguing that being overweight or obese is your right. So therefore, the government shouldn't require them to sell healthier food. I'm going to show you another ad from that beef jerky one that didn't work before. After watching it, I want you to ask yourself if you think junk food advertisers are really freeing you from a cage, or if they're laughing at you because they know that even after you've been let out, you'll still be docile and eat the junk food they're selling you.
Jack Link's jerky. Feed your wild side.
Now, I want to take you into another presentation for you. This one talks about how food advertisers work so hard to shape our culture. They don't want to just sell their products. They want you to believe that using their product, it's always normal, no matter what the nutritional value of their product may be, and no matter what health consequences you may have from consuming it. Food advertisers don't want you to just consume their products occasionally. They want people to think that every single occasion is the right time to consume their products. And if you overcome or binge on their products, they'll be happy to take your money, but they'll blame you for your lack of control. totally avoiding any responsibility for the billions of dollars they spend telling you to eat and eat and eat their product. Food advertising can be so powerful that many times it shapes our culture. Many habits, traditions that people enjoy are the results of ads. Let's take a look at how one advertising campaign shaped the way we celebrate Christmas.
He's big and jolly. He wears a red and white suit, and his smiling face is known all over the world. But believe it or not, Santa Claus owes at least part of his popularity to a beverage company.
Well, in 1931, the Coca-Cola Company was trying to find a way to associate Coca-Cola with the holidays. And so they commissioned an artist named Haddon Sunbloom to create advertising for Coca-Cola that included a holiday motif.
Before this Coke advertising campaign, Santa Claus was almost always shown wearing a green suit. His clothes were very similar to what we usually see as elves wearing. But since Coca-Cola always uses red, they had Santa wear red themselves. Now, these ads were shown so often that other people started putting Santa Claus in red clothes. Before long, all the songs and all the movies about Saint Nick featured his red suit. It's kind of odd to think that Santa was wearing green, but before Coke's advertising, that's how he was dressed. This is only one example of how advertising can shape our view of what's normal. Consider these facts. Children spend more than 38 hours a week using media, whether it's television, video games, music, computers, any of that. 38 hours a week, that's a full-time job. The average child sees 40,000 ads every single year on TV. And that doesn't include radio, print, internet, billboards, that's only TV. A large portion of the ads children see are for unhealthy products. Numerous research studies have shown a positive correlation between hours of television viewing and obesity. So much so that 25 to 30% of American children are profoundly overweight. Given how powerful media is at shaping our culture, it makes sense that there's a strong link between consuming media and being overweight. What's really creepy about all this is how commercial media tries to make it seem that kids being overweight is a normal thing, not something that's being created by all the inactivity that comes from 38 hours a week of sitting and watching, or from seeing 40,000 ads a year, most of which sell unhealthy products. In fact, this next ad I'm going to show you tries to make an overweight child seem normal by making his overweightness seem cute.
Don't you wish Bounty made napkins? Well, guess what? Bounty quilted napkins are finally here. The stronger, longer lasting napkin, Bounty.
See, this ad tries to sell a stronger napkin by showing us a gluttonous child who takes so many bites of food that his pile of used napkins get bigger than he is. Well, by using fun music and focusing on the napkins, not the food, the ad draws attention away from the fact that the child actor is obese. His weight is just part of the ad's background, something advertisers hope you'll view as normal. In fact, childhood obesity is an epidemic. Government tracking studies show that in 1999, nearly 1 in 6 children were overweight. This is 4 times the number of kids and teens that were overweight in 1970. Children who are overweight suffer from all kinds of physiological and physical problems. Let's listen to one teenage girl tell it from her point of view.
I think it's very, very hard for overweight teenagers because you're always going to see the thin, pretty, popular girls. And you can't help but look at them and think, I wish I was her, or I wish I could have that. And I mean, it's depressing. It makes you feel like crap. I mean, that's just how it is. And And it's hard being a teenager because you see all the girls in the Cosmo Girl or Teen People, and they're all beautiful. And you think, aren't I supposed to look like that? And it's not realistic. It's not a realistic way to live.
Girls who are overweight have it particularly hard, since the fashion industry only sells images of beauty that are thin. The way our culture celebrates beauty is heavily shaped by advertising, as is the way our culture treats food. For overweight girls, our culture of beauty really takes its toll on their self-esteem. There are a huge number of research studies that report teen girls who are overweight experience stigmatization. They suffer through direct and intentional weight-related teasing, jokes, derogatory name-calling, as well as less intentional, potentially hurtful comments by peers, family, employers, and strangers. Overweight children and teens, both boys and girls, also report negative assumptions are frequently made about them by others, including people assuming that they're inactive, they're lazy, they're stronger and tougher than others, they don't have feelings, that they're unclean. Beyond the physiological trauma, children and teens who are overweight have to face some pretty serious physical health problems. The most dangerous is type 2 diabetes. Now, type 2 diabetes accounted for less than 4% of childhood diabetes before 1992. And since 1994, it accounts for 16%. Now, a person with type 2 diabetes before age 15 will lose between 17 and 27 years off the end of their life. Obese children and teens are over 12 times as likely to have high fasting blood insulin levels, a key risk factor for type 2 diabetes. Now, of course, junk food advertisers don't make ads telling you that this is the result of consuming their product. In their ads, everyone is healthy, slim, and happy. One in five obese children have some other liver damage. About half show the early signs of liver problems. Overweight children are significantly more asthmatic. Simple breathing can be difficult. Increased weight can cause pain, limit range of motion as your hip bone plates grow. 7% of obese children have sleep apnea. Their lost sleep makes logical thinking difficult. This obesity creates so many problems. And advertisers never tell us. Everyone is always healthy, slim, and happy. Let's look at some junk food ads to see how they try to make consuming unhealthy products seem normal. Now, this ad shows that drinking Coke is part of friendship. It's like having second family because they all have Coca-Cola. And the ad says, that's real. Consuming junk food together is what makes your friendship close, then you might want to ask what friends like this will do when they're together. Well, the answer, of course, they'll go clubbing.
What are we going to do tonight?
Hey, let's go clubbing.
Oh, yeah!
Get into Taco Bell for our exclusive Club Chalupa, a classic club mix of crisp bacon and marinated grilled all-white meat chicken. Spun into our very own crispy, chewy chalupa shell for fresh club taste worth sinking your teeth into. To get into Club Chalupa, you gotta think outside the bun.
Of course, this ad's a joke. And it's even kind of funny to see these guys dancing in place with the chalupas they're holding. But the reason we can laugh at an ad like this is because we understand the lifestyle it's supposed to be making fun of. Some guys do consider going out for fast food as an enjoyable way to spend their evenings together. And by making their behavior into a joke, as this ad does, it makes it seem that mimicking these guys is no big deal. Going out to get fast food as the highlight of your evening becomes normalized. This next ad also uses the same humorous technique to disarm audiences. By making a joke out of how people mimic what they see a star do in this ad, the advertisers can make the behavior seem normal.
Hey, I'm late for this award show. Can I get a ride?
Come on, hop in. I tell you, Carson, the excitement here is tremendous. Look at that.
I didn't know P. Diddy drove a Diet Pepsi truck.
Don't scratch it.
All right, this is how I roll.
Hey, yo, P! Check out my new ride.
You know, even though we laugh at ads like this, the joke is on us. We are the people who mimic the behaviors shown when we purchase the products that these ads push. And let's face it, if advertising didn't have such a powerful effect on us, do you think the junk food corporations would be wasting billions of dollars to pay for it?
We'll go to McDonald's.
Did somebody say McDonald's?
I could go for a Big Mac.
And some McDonald's fries.
McDonald's.
Did somebody say McDonald's?
In this ad, just saying the word McDonald's is enough to get everyone to leave the middle of a movie to go eat there. The word McDonald's is so powerful that even the characters in the movie stop chasing each other and head there. You know, as we've seen from the data I presented earlier, this is not too far from the truth. Children and teens consume a lot of media and then end up buying and eating the junk food products that are sold by that media they watch. This happens so often it seems normal to us. Most teens think that eating junk food is natural since they see many of their friends eating that way. But if what the ads don't show you is the consequence you'll suffer from living on a junk food diet. Not a single person in any of these ads were overweight. 64% of adult Americans are overweight. 64%. That's 2 out of 3. Now, if these ads showed what was real, they'd look more like this. And it's not just that these ads show only thin people eating junk food. There are so many junk food ads that what our little government spends on teaching people to eat healthy gets drowned out.
Companies spend billions making sure you know their product. In 2001, on direct media advertising, that's radio, television, and print, McDonald's spent $1.4 billion worldwide. On direct media advertising, Pepsi spent more than $1 billion. To advertise its candy, Hershey Foods spent under a mere $200 million internationally. In its peak year, the five-a-day fruit and vegetable campaign's total advertising budget in all media was a lowly $2 million, 100 times less than just the direct media budget of one candy company.
Now, because of lawsuits against them, junk food giants began to offer their own nutrition and healthy eating programs. Just like the government programs, the healthy eating programs food companies promote are also severely underfunded. And worse yet, many of them are either just more advertising in disguise or just plain lame. Here's one. Kids can go to the Kellogg's Nutrition Camp website and learn that calories are the action heroes of the food world. Or if you write to McDonald's, they're happy to send you nutrition education programs like this one.
Hi, I'm Willie.
This is a library for William Bartholomew Montrose.
Hey, it's a letter. Dear Willie, is it okay to eat cake every day? Ben eating. Excellent question, Ben. Cake is what we call a sometimes food. So are chips, candy, and other sweet things. It's okay to eat these sometimes, just not all the time. It's kind of like going to the zoo. It wouldn't be as good to go every day.
Willie's back.
Oh, boy.
But just like monkeys play every day, and birds sing every day, it's good for us kids to eat plenty of everyday foods every day. Like bananas, corn, rice, lean meat, and 1% milk. Foods like these come first, then you can have your cake. And eat it too. Zap your hunger and thirst with everyday foods first. That's what's on your plate.
Now, We've all seen thousands of McDonald's ads. Not one of them looks as lame as this commercial just did. The ad they used to sell their food are way more slick. But putting production values aside for a moment, what exactly is this ad saying to kids? Cake is a sometimes food. The ad never bothers to tell us what sometimes means. Does it mean only once a month? Or once an hour? After stating a list of everyday foods, the ad does say, foods like these come first. Then you can have your cake. The little girl in the ad then says, and eat it too! So the only clear message in the ad is, eat your cake after you've eaten all the other foods we've told you about. So instead of limiting the amount of food or portion sizes to be consumed, this ad tells kids to eat more. So not only are nutrition messages to kids very few and far in between, but the ones produced by junk food corporations are often poorly produced and never warn kids to stay away from the products marketed. But because so many people are suffering from obesity, most food corporations are offering products they want you to believe are healthier. Now, this next ad makes the claim about being healthy, but it wants you to believe that the product offered is supposed to be a salad.
A salad is a salad, right? Wrong. When you add fresh field greens, blue cheese crumbles, cool ranch dressing, and all the flavor of Chili's famous boneless buffalo wings, you get another amazing salad. Chili's new boneless buffalo chicken salad.
So this ad starts by asking the question, a salad is a salad, right? Then it quickly answers its own question. Wrong. In fact, this product has almost none of the health benefits you'd get from eating a salad. If you were to order a dinner salad at Chili's, it would have 140 calories and 7 grams of fat. Now, if you dress that salad with 2 ounces of their most popular dressing, ranch, you'd add another 240 calories and 25 grams of fat. That's lesson number one. The dressing served with this salad has 170% more calories and over 3 times the fat than the salad itself. Now, if you ordered the boneless buffalo chicken salad advertised in the commercial with the dressing, you'd get 1,150 and 84 grams of fat. That's 300% more calories and almost 3 times the fat as the dinner salad with the dressing. That's lesson number two. It doesn't matter what an advertiser calls it. Until you check the nutritional information yourself, don't believe what they're saying. Nutritionally, this product isn't a salad. It's just buffalo wings served on a bed of lettuce. You don't get the benefit of consuming more fiber, but don't think this is a healthy meal just because it's called a salad. Now, please don't think that all things that advertisers label as healthy or call salad are bad for you. Some are actually very good. McDonald's, for example, offers a fruit and walnut salad that is very healthy. It only has 310 calories and a gram and a half of saturated fat. It's even pretty low in salt with only 90 milligrams. But in order to know that this product is healthy, you have to be able to find, then read, and understand the nutritional information put out by McDonald's. Since they don't have labels or easy to read signs in their stores, you're pretty much playing a hit or miss game for determining what's nutritious if you're going only by the name of a product.
A nice substitute for the hot fudge sundae would be the yogurt.
That is true. If you get the snack size, 5 ounces. If you get the regular size without granola, it contains nearly as many calories as a strawberry sundae. With granola, it has more calories than the hot fudge or caramel sundae.
You see how confusing it is to eat healthy food? Junk food companies don't make it easy to find out what's really in their food, and they'll often use names that are very misleading. Let's look a little more closely at one product, chicken nuggets. Now, this photo is a hoax, but it's funny to look at because it makes us think about what's really in chicken nuggets. A while back, somebody claimed to find this in their chicken nuggets and posted the picture on the internet. Well, the truth is it never really happened. But if you find out what McDonald's does put in its McNuggets, you may be just as grossed out. A few years ago, the movie Super Size Me contained this report.
In the lawsuit against them, McDonald's stated in their own defense that it's a matter of common knowledge that any processing that its foods undergo serve to make them more harmful than unprocessed foods. Case in point, McNuggets. Originally created from old chickens that could no longer lay eggs, McNuggets are now made from chickens with unusually large breasts. They're stripped from the bone and ground up into a sort of chicken mash, which is then combined with all sorts of stabilizers and preservatives, pressed into familiar shapes, breaded, deep-fried, freeze-dried, and then shipped to a McDonald's near you. Judge Robert Sweet called them a McFrankenstein creation of various elements not utilized by the home cook.
Now, when McDonald's first introduced their McNuggets, fish, not just chicken, was one of the main ingredients they used. But since the lawsuit reported the clip from the supersized movie mentioned, there's been a lot of public attention given to McNuggets. So McDonald's has recently moved to using boneless chicken breast as the primary ingredients in McNuggets. Now, here's an ad celebrating how they've changed their recipe.
I decided to make some serious changes. And now chicken McNuggets are made with white meat. If they can change for the better, so can I.
This ad tells us that since McNuggets have changed for the better, this actor has been inspired to make changes in his life as well. You know, it's kind of sorry, isn't it, that McDonald's wants us to think processed food should be a role model for our lives? But like all the ads we've seen, this one wants people to think that making junk food is a central feature in our lives is normal. Since we've learned that healthy claims may not really mean that food is good for you, let's take a moment to see what kind of nutrition McNuggets have to offer. In August of 2005, the McDonald's website listed this information for its four-piece McNuggets. 170 calories, 10 grams of fat, 2 grams, which are saturated fat, and 1 gram being trans fat. These kinds of fat are the worst for you. In fact, trans fat is so bad that the government is requiring it to be removed from food in the near future. Even though they've got new recipe and new fancy commercials inspiring people to make changes, it appears McDonald's is waiting until their government requires them to get rid of trans fat before they're willing to do so. Now, a four-piece order of McNuggets also contains 8% of the recommended daily value for cholesterol and 19% of the daily recommendation for salt. Salt is so important to look for as nutrition. It's a leading cause of high blood pressure and contributes to other nasty diseases that attack your heart. Salt is often overlooked in processed food because manufacturers rely so heavily on it. They need it as a preservative, and frankly, most processed food would be tasteless if it wasn't loaded with salt. Now, ask yourself, have you ever ordered McNuggets or any similar processed chicken lumps at a fast food joint? Okay, now, when you do, because I'll bet most of you have, do you usually get the four-piece or something bigger? Now, I would guess most people don't just eat a four-piece chicken McNugget meal. A common trick food corporations use is to have an incredibly small portion of something on their menu. They do this for several reasons. A small portioned item allows them to make health claims that are fairly reasonable. Overall, the numbers on the four-piece McNugget aren't so bad. But since few people order such small portions, the claims are unrealistic. Also, offering a small portion item on their menus allows companies like McDonald's to shift blame. They can say it's overeaters without the willpower to eat less of this obesity-causing stuff. It's not our food. It's not our problem. There's some truth to this, but it really is very cynical. Since they also sell much larger portions, since they heavily advertise consistent consumption of these products, companies who try to blame consumers for overeating are simply giving us a wink and a nod. They're shifting blame away from the responsibility they have from luring in overeaters and the profits they make from catering to them. Since very few people eat just four McNuggets at a time, let's look at some of the numbers for a 10-piece order. It's got 240 calories, not too bad, 24 grams of fat, holy cow, that's 2,000 2/3 of what's recommended each day for most teens. 5 grams of saturated fat, that's just asking for a heart disease. 2.5 grams of trans fat, loading in on the toxins. 21% of the daily recommended value for cholesterol. 47% of the daily recommended value for salt. That's almost half of your salt for a day in just one food item. Hey, why stop there though? How about a 20 piece? Some people eat those. 840 calories, 49 grams of fat, 14 grams more than is recommended for a single day, 11 grams of saturated fat, 5 grams of trans fat, 41% of the daily recommended value of cholesterol, and 93% of the daily recommended value for salt. So if you eat this, you are endangering your health by consuming practically any other salt all day long. But it gets worse. McDonald's serves their nuggets with dipping sauce. If you use only one container of it, which is unlikely with the larger orders, you'll add another 40 to 50 calories and up to 11% of the daily recommended value for salt, depending on what flavor you choose. So remember the guy in the nuggets ad who was inspired to make changes? You thinking he was making any real changes? Or do you think the changes he made were just on the surface, like shaving his eyebrows? I'd like to know if you're inspired to make changes, particularly changes to your eating habits. I'm hoping that this lesson has inspired you to change to a healthier diet. Are you going to pledge allegiance to giant food corporations who are happy to profit from selling unhealthy junk? Or are you going to pledge allegiance to yourself and make healthy choices around the foods and drinks you eat? Now, you've seen all those ads for like Bacardi Cooler, Smirnoff Ice, and other sweetened soda flavor alcohol drinks. Not one of them ever shows you an overweight person drinking down their sugar-sweetened alcohol. The question you need to be asking yourself is if you really think the unconscious eating and drinking habits you're shown in commercial media are really normal, or are they fake? And if they're fake, then who's holding your lease? Is it you making good food choices, or is it advertisers who profit from you being overweight that are calling the shots in your life?